Jordy and I did not like this film, despite it being one of the most acclaimed films of the entire year.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Oral Tradition. This is your Palerinos, Jordy Matheson.
And David Borges.
And we're here for our second episode. I know you've all been waiting so very desperately after our Rogue One review. Ooh. So much has happened, and it makes sense that after Rogue One, we'd decide to review a film very similar in tone.
Yeah,
very
really.
Very similar in style and quality. But overall, a better film, perhaps. The film is Call Me By Your Name.
Call Me By Your Name.
Call me by your name and I'll call you by mine.
I just wanted to quickly read some of those brilliant comments that were left.
Yeah, thank
really,
you so much.
Really incisive conversation was happening in the comment section of our video.
Like, we thought about stopping the comment because there was just such an overflowing of amazing comments, and it really got heated.
Exactly. Comments like, which one is you? And who's the one who isn't you? Existential stuff.
Incredible.
I thought.
Yeah.
Then there was another great one that, like, honestly, like, shook me up emotionally. It was, I think YouTube auto-subscribed me because I have no idea who you guys are, and you showed up in my feed as subscribed.
Thank you so much for that.
Thank you so much for that, Tony Joseph.
Tony Joseph. You know, when we started this podcast...
All those years ago,
we were just hoping that we'd get comments like that, that we've really affected people's lives, and so we have.
Can we take a brief second to talk about the sort of change in format, that like the change in direction that we're going for
sure.
with this show?
Sure, I mean, we can give it a... Yeah, sure.
Just a one-minute summary. Essentially, The Oral Tradition is a queer film focused podcast where we are deciding whether or not the films that we're seeing stay or get shot out of the queer canon.
Yeah, we take these films from the present and the past that are...
Maybe the future.
And maybe the future. We'll pull from the future once we get the technology. Subscribe on Patreon. We don't have Patreon.
Subscribe on ICQ and Ubuntu servers for all of the updates regarding The Oral Tradition.
Yeah, and then we'll review those films and we'll say if they're valuable as queer LGBT stories, and also perhaps concurrently or separately good as movies.
So I'm ready to get into it. Are you ready to get into it? This is our review for Call Me By Your Name. What is the premise of Call Me By Your Name?
It is 1983 in Northern Italy, specifically the Lombardy region. A family of archaeologists are convening over a summer in their Italian villa. And each summer, the husband, wife, and their 17-year-old son, named Elio, come to this place, and they invite a doctoral student to come over and do research with the family and work on their doctoral dissertation. This summer, the person who comes is the beautiful, the one and only, Armie Hammer.
Armie Hammy,
playing Oliver. Suffice it to say, Elio and Armie Hammy, aka Oliver, start a budding relationship. And though there are difficulties in the language barrier, by which I mean both are mumble pants, they find connection in the end for the purposes of true love, aka bonage. That's
the premise.
The movie.
That's a great premise.
Thank you.
So, Jordy and I did not like this film, despite it being one of the most acclaimed films of the entire year.
No, it was, it's not, it wasn't for us. But we don't want to seem like we're disliking it out of pushback because it was popular, or because Especially not because it has, like, a gay relationship.
No.
In the center. We definitely want to see queer stories.
Mm-hmm.
We just feel, for multiple reasons, that perhaps this film didn't need to exist.
Yeah.
And we hope that Hollywood takes note.
Yeah, of our scathing review and in-depth commentary over the successes and mostly failures of this film, which we will promptly get into. Did you have any bias for or against this film going into it?
Yes.
Which way?
It seemed like a bunch of rich artists moping around in a beautiful Italian villa for 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just a story that I have trouble watching films that are just like romantic portrayals of rich intelligentsia.
Ooh. Yeah.
If there isn't any like satire or critique of that culture, because yeah, this just seemed like a card that you send, a postcard, a romantic postcard to that world, and it didn't seem, and the main conflict was like, these two gay guys like each other, but will they sleep with each other? Which is like,
yeah,
the oldest queer narrative ever. So it just didn't seem like it had anything super interesting.
Before even seeing it.
That was just from watching the trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And I got that sense from that. And so that was my feeling going in. How about yourself?
Exactly the same feeling. I was not super stoked, especially because of the culture that we're living in these days of people talking about sexual impropriety. A sort of relationship between, you know, with like a 10-year age gap, specifically when one of the characters is supposed to be 16 or 17.
17, yeah.
Yeah, and we've been seeing steep age gaps in film relationships before.
Oh,
this seems incredibly dated in a post-Moonlight world and in a world where specifically gay relationships and gay art, like one of our favorites.
Moonlight?
No. Angels in America.
Angels in America.
Just deals so much more bluntly with a lot of the themes of, you know, romance and how relationships work and how relationships sound between gay people as well. I know it's like a completely different medium, but like,
yeah,
everything about Call Me By Your Name as we were going into it was like, just seemed real at arm's length. Like, so much of the movie is just about like the tension of just keeping you just a little bit distant from the characters. And it just makes for real just emo, sad sack kind of storytelling. And those are my feelings before seeing the movie. Like, we were both pretty strongly biased against it.
Yeah.
So we'll get that out of the
way. Yeah, we had our feelings going in. And, however, I should say, I like James Ivory, the writer, who was the writer, producer, like a major person in it. I've seen many of the films of Merchant Ivory, which was his production company, which he directed with Ismail Merchant. And they made such films as Howard's End, A Room with a View, Remains of the Day. So these are all also very classy, non-challenging, pretty-looking adaptations of famous pieces of pastoral English literature. And I really enjoyed those. So I enjoyed them because the characters are strong, the world seemed very concrete, and the stakes are, they exist. So I was hoping going in, like we had those feelings, but then also hoping that it would prove us wrong and be more akin to the films that I really loved of James Ivory, which are just really tightly, well-acted historical pieces.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, before we poo-poo it too much, because we've already kind of been...
It's true. We can talk about what works.
Yeah, what worked? What did we like? What did you like? Devo.
Well, I did enjoy a lot of the nonverbal storytelling, a lot of the physicalizing of the characters' inner dilemmas, the sort of, like, hesitations of early romance played out really well. I really enjoyed a lot of that tension, and a lot of, like, yeah, just a lot of the awkward pauses, or, like, there's a sequence that I enjoyed where Elio is sort of waiting for midnight, where he has scheduled a rendezvous with Oliver, and while he's waiting for this, he's basically, you know, relieving himself sexually with a girl. And throughout all those interactions, there are these framed, or there are these sort of like hints toward, or like pauses on
the
a
watch.
Clock or a watch, which is just a really nice way of showing where his mind is at while he's in this sort of like other place mentally. So that I really appreciated. I thought that's super, like, yeah, it's just super solid visual storytelling. And I did like the score. I thought the score was lovely. And I do like looking at, I'll say it, Jordy, I do enjoy ogling Armie Hammy and Timothy Chalamet.
Yep, there's a simple pleasure in beautiful figures.
Mm-hmm.
And like that was, I feel like that was a part of this, is that it's a very, a film full of sensational, sensual pleasures. So there's a lot of eating food and plucking ripe fruit from the vine.
Ooh.
And
yes.
Long, like, everybody's shirtless most of the time.
Yep.
And if they aren't shirtless, they're wearing really flowy things. Now, that probably is because it's set in Italy during the summer, so it's probably hot, hot, hot. Mm-hmm. But nobody's actually, like, sweaty or uncomfortable or, like, fanning themselves.
I was just going to say that there were plenty of shots of Timothy Chalamet glistening because of sweat. I noticed.
I thought those were just because he was coming out of, like... A lot of those were after he was swimming.
Right.
Like, he swam a lot. It's true. He was sweaty sometimes.
I think there were some sweaty shots. But it's never like the gross...
No, that's like, exactly.
Ugh, let's go inside. Like, just the really...
Yeah, suffocating.
Really, like, miserable heat.
Always, like, just pretty.
Yeah.
And there's definitely reflective shots of those beautiful statues... which characters comment on how the statues... The archaeologist's dad is, like, researching Roman and Greek and Roman statuary. And the people are like, oh, they're such beautiful, beautiful, sensual statues. And then they'll cut to, like, Timothy Chalamet just, like, sprawled out on his bed. And you're like, okay, okay. Good stuff.
Good stuff.
So that's,
stuff.
That is fun. And
so, yeah.
I like that. I loved the character, the man who plays the dad.
Oh, yes.
The man who plays the dad, whose name is Michael Stuhlbarg. He's great. He's in all sorts of fantastic films, and he has a monologue at the end, which has been praised quite a lot. And we'll talk more about that, but I did like that moment.
Yeah.
And I did enjoy the opening, like, having a title sequence for a film that's like that, and like an art house film is so rare nowadays. So often it's just like cut to, or like it's
things happening and then the titles are sort of squirreled away to the side.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I like that that's true. Had that. It felt very, again, a throwback to a different type of film.
Mm-hmm.
So I like that. And there was some beautiful imagery, some beautiful bodies. And the music was nice. It wasn't original, though. It was all...
Really?
Yeah, it was
all... Were those all covers?
Those are all just, like, famous classical pieces.
Really?
Like, yeah, you can see it here. John Adams.
Whoa.
Ruccio Sakamoto. Ivano Fossati. Eric Satie. Bach. Huh. Raval.
Oh my gosh.
And then they say that Soufran Stevens, like, wrote the score,
okay.
But he actually only, he just gave...
Transposed it.
No, he just gave two songs, I think.
Right, okay, okay.
Or, and perhaps they were reformed, but I think they
No. Yeah, we're seeing that the performers are a collection of artists.
Yeah.
So
it's just a mixed track.
It's kind of a greatest hits. I mean, I'd be lying if I said I wasn't going to find the soundtrack and play it while I'm, like, writing or studying or something.
No, it's a great minimalist soundtrack, for sure. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I have a segue.
Okay, go.
So, as far as, like, the film being positive, this is sort of, like, a middling point because it has more to do with the way... Yeah, I don't know. It requires, like, guessing the intentions of the filmmaker. But we started talking a bit about how... the film, in a lot of ways, like you used the word pastoral. When I was talking about it earlier, I used the word utopic. I don't know if it's a word, but one of my theories watching the film that maybe helped me to like see into it a little bit more is that it's almost supposed to be, oh my God, it's almost supposed to be, I'm seeing what Jordy's looking up, and it's the word bucolic.
I don't know if it's a real word.
I am pretty positive it is a word.
Yeah, relating to a pleasant aspects of the countryside and country life.
Nailed it. So that's another one. Apologies for the background noise if you're hearing some banging in the background. That's our neighbor.
That's our neighbor. He plays his music real loud.
Yeah, and maybe hides bodies in his cupboards.
That'll be the ongoing, like, under-narrative of this podcast is...
Yeah.
Is our upstairs neighbor a serial killer? Find out!
Find out in episode 3.
You'll only find out if you stay tuned.
What helped me enjoy the film was this sort of underlying idea that maybe this was a film made to sort of feel like a vacation and feel like this sort of idea of what would a world be like where everyone had these beautiful homes and accepting parents and great looks and just all the people fawning over them and sort of fall for someone of an age difference that they prefer or whatever.
And there's nothing weird about it.
There's nothing weird about it. You get to just enjoy each other.
Yeah.
And so this idea of the film sort of being a fantasy in a lot of ways, like this very sort of... fantasy.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Fantastical.
I'm so like uninvested in my own reading of the film, but that's kind of how I was trying to look at it. Like they're trying to make the most pleasant romance possible, the most least conflicting, like heart-wrenching romance possible, because maybe they wanted to just make something softer and wanted to make something mostly about surface level pleasures.
Yeah, so there's a kind of historical film style that was very popular in the French New Wave had a little bit of it. Jean Renoir had a lot of films that had this style, and they were pretty much just these pastorals where characters would wander through the countryside, eating well, drinking port, and so as I was reading about this film a little bit, there was a quote from the director, but at one point the director was talking about films that he admired and directors that inspired this film, and he specifically mentioned Jacques Rivette, Eric Rohmer, Bernardo Bertolucci. Hmm. So all these filmmakers who are known for making these sumptuous, visually beautiful films about people having pleasurable experiences. So that's kind of... I definitely can see this. And also, he said that it was a part of a trilogy called his Desire Trilogy,
okay,
which also has a film called I Am Love and a film called A Bigger Splash. And those, from what I've seen, are similarly visually sumptuous, though perhaps a little bit more dramatic. He said specifically that this was a film that he was trying to make the most leisurely, calmly paced film that he'd ever made.
The reason that is kind of like a middling point, like it's not necessarily for or against the film, is that there is a value to films not necessarily being and LGBT films specifically not necessarily just being a series of horrific strife.
Yeah, yeah.
Just a real trundle through misery.
People just having, you know, AIDS, cancer, and mm-hmm. yeah, being attacked and subjugated. Mm-hmm. So there is a value in showing, like, what a positive experience can be for the LGBT community. And that's why I think our upstairs neighbor is a serial killer.
Exactly.
So, as I was saying about Call Me By Your Name...
You were saying about how we're supposed to, at the end of the film, we're supposed to empathize with this character, that for basically action story reasons, we never really got much of a reason, because he never really does that much in earnest.
Yeah.
Like, he does a lot of things while he's scoffing or sulking or, like, kind of fighting against himself, and is very just, like, broody and distant, etc.
And one of the great, like...
One of the great
bits of storytelling 101 is that it's very hard. You can make a sympathetic character who has, like, good intentions and
like our neighbor has very good intentions
for the bodies.
When he kills bodies.
Good intentions and have. Like, and are active. Like, people value characters who make choices. That's why anti-heroes work. It's because oftentimes anti-heroes, even though they're doing, morally gray or bad things, they're making these steps. They're saying, I have cancer. I'm going to start making meth now. I'm going to do this. I'm going to kill this guy. Like, as a character, to have... The most important thing in a protagonist that makes a protagonist empathetic or someone that can be, you can follow in a story is having an intention. Elio, the character, the main character in this film, Timothée Chalamet's character, mostly is just like stuck in this ennui sensation, and he doesn't really do much, as you said. Mm-hmm. So it makes it hard to empathize when he also... Yeah, when anything ever happens, he seems like kind of to push back mm-hmm. against it, which makes sense to have like a young person be like that. And I will also say that the novel version is set from the point of view as Elio as a grown-up talking about his experience as a young person.
Oh my God.
And then they also cut... they have the part in 1983 or like the earlier days, and then Oliver and Elio meet like 10 years later and then 20 years later.
Whoa!
Yeah, and so they see the changes and it becomes much more akin to Brokeback Mountain.
Sure.
That's more about the ways in which people make sacrifices and do not experience those romances and how those affect them over their life. We don't know how this affects Elio because we don't get to see him grow or change.
No.
At all, really. And I think it would have been valuable to see a little bit of Elio as an adult, or perhaps a little bit of Elio's point of view of what he, what he learned, mm-hmm. what he gained.
Yeah, yeah. And like as hokey as they can sound, even just like, a narration of like an adult or like of his own father or whatever, basically talking in past tense about the story of like what Elio went through in that experience, to sort of solidify or make it more clear that everyone else is sort of in on the fact that Elio is this very kind of like repressed, hesitant, sulky character.
Yeah.
And then it sort of makes more sense in universe that he's not going to be happy because he's not making these choices and etc.
Exactly.
And then you get the sense that there is a sort of higher wisdom within the film that's sort of saying these things mm-hmm. that the audience is probably thinking or wondering about by the end of the film.
Yeah.
Like, why does that kid suck so much? Like, if you have some narration going on of saying, like,
Yeah.
It was at that moment that I realized that I was making the wrong choice when I was pushing him away, like that sort of thing. Like, I mean, that's very on the nose.
Totally.
But
exactly. It's yeah, but a little bit more of that, because I feel like the characters can be hard to understand their motivations. They can act in very sort of strange ways.
Mm-hmm. Which I think segues nicely into our feelings about the dialogue and our feelings about the way that these characters speak about themselves and about and to each other.
Yeah, like the especially the central like romantic thing. I think they were aiming for Oliver and Elio to have this just such a palpable sense of lust and passion between them that they can't communicate, and so they just talk about these awkward non-conversation mm-hmm. things.
Yeah. You're saying that's how you were going into the film, sort of expecting a bit more of that?
I think that's what maybe they were trying to do.
Okay, yeah.
That's not how it comes across. It comes across as them just being awkward, and not able to communicate, at all. And yeah, I can't think of any specific examples, but if you watch the film, it'll just seem like, why are these people communicating the way they're communicating? Did you have any thoughts or any add-ons?
Well, yeah. This maybe is a bit of a stereotype, but so much of academic relationships, as well as gay relationships, is this very, like, hyper-verbal thing going on.
Talking, making jokes, mm-hmm. talking about, like, yeah, especially if you're academic, you know, having these similar interests and being passionate about these intellectual things, and part of the sense of like passion between two people that can develop from that is the feeling of them both being on the same level and being able to either argue and agree and feel like the agreeing has a value and validates their point of view and engages them, and they have none of that. No. They just talk about papers not being in the right order, or wanting to go bicycling, and nothing. There's not really a whole lot of conversation between the two, so it's left feeling like they don't really love each other. They just are physically attracted to each other and want a bone, and that's all they talk about afterwards. And mm-hmm. and then there's a lot of like laughing. There's a lot of that cliche of lazy writing, where you'll cut to people laughing after they've done the funny thing, so the writer doesn't have to show what they're laughing at or the connection. You could just assume that they must have been doing this really fun thing, and then you can go back to them just laughing and kissing, which is easier to write.
Yep, I can think of two examples of that.
Yeah.
One of them is not with Elio and Oliver. One of them is with the two mm-hmm. of them. The one with Elio and Oliver is when they're on a vacation toward the last, like the, you know, closing fourth of the film.
Yeah.
Is when they're just sort of wandering around town. They basically do this sort of escape because it's easier for Oliver to travel from that second location or something like that.
In Rome, yeah. They go to Rome.
And so they're wandering through the street, and there's just a sort of cut to a like dark alley or like dark underneath a bridge or whatever, and they're just wandering down the street just lollygagging and giggling and having a grand old time, but we don't know about what. I thought they were going to like explain and they like walk into the hotel and they're laughing
period.
About something.
They're hiking up a mountain and running and laughing,
and they're just
for
screaming.
Like 5 minutes like it's not like that's not how romance, it looks like they're just crazy people, like they're people who are unhinged and they're just screaming and laughing. But you never actually see ever what they're laughing mm-hmm. about. It's just like this...
Yeah, they're just in the mountains going,
young love.
I love the water.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't, there's no logic brought to it, which might be the intentional passionateness, but I want to see. I think of a film like the Before series, like Before Sunrise, Before Sunset.
I was gonna say that. We didn't talk about this, but I was gonna say the same thing.
Very similar concept to lovers meeting, being forced to separate at the end. And it's they never, I don't think they even kiss, or they, if they do kiss, oh yeah, they kiss like a little bit in sex, but I know there's a little bit of sexual stuff, but it's all at the back. The most important thing is them learning about each other, chatting, seeing the contours of each other's beliefs and world and mindset.
Mm-hmm.
And that's much more important to romance and relationships than like that giddy laughter and sexual passion. Because that's the first thing. That's the first thing that goes. I'm gonna tell you.
I don't want it to sound stereotypical or like sex negative or any of this stuff, because those things are great. It's more the idea that it's just not a believable relationship, and they're very, very poorly drawn characters, and that I don't necessarily buy the idea that the less that's said between the two of them, the more universal it is. Because yeah, I don't know.
That's Twilight logic.
Yeah. Really is.
And yeah, this is like Twilight without the vampires.
Oh shit, Jordy!
Yeah. And it's all just brooding and moping and nobody making choices and just nothing romantic. really.
Yeah.
Our point of view.
To our point of view!
It's such a popular film, and a lot of the things that we're mentioning are things that other people mention as a positive. Like,
yeah, so go figure.
So maybe, who knows?
But. I was gonna say, I don't know, I've been learning something, or hearing tell of things around art and around storytelling or comedy or what have you.
That specificity,
within the specific, we find the universal, and within the, thank you, within the sort of well-drawn reality of two characters, the sort of belief that these are two, you know, real, believable people, there's this sort of idea that we start to empathize and realize, like, oh, the way they're connecting, the stuff that they're bonding with each other about is very similar to the things that I would bond with someone about.
Totally.
As opposed to it just being this really empty space of primal screams and averted glances.
Exactly.
And glistening torsos.
Glistening torsos and stolen stairs.
And falling in the water.
Yeah, and lying on the cool grass and grabbing each other's crotches. But no conversations and no...
But no conversations.
No anything. So at the end there's this monologue that comes up. And it's spoken by the father of the main character Elio, saying, you know what, I don't even judge you for the love that you feel for your relationship with him. I'm actually jealous because I've felt that way in my life and I didn't go for it. Mm-hmm. And you should just go for it while you're young and people want to look at you, mm-hmm. which is a kind of, I don't know how I feel about that. As a moral, but I wrote that if loving who you want while you can is the moral of this story, then was this the best story to present that message?
Mm-hmm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
Why this story? Because at the end, that monologue about love who you can while you can, doesn't super have a lot to do with the story that was told, which is more about two attractive people, like, who are able to really, could have any, like, have everybody. Like, the girls love them. They sleep with all the girls.
Mm-hmm.
They
yeah, they're with, real flirts.
They're real flirts.
We haven't said, or, like, we've alluded to it.
Yeah.
But, like, yeah, they really, really go for other people.
So would it be a more succinct representation of that moral or that meta, that theme, had they been two people who weren't just like vivacious young flirts,
mm-hmm.
or like two people who really found something genuinely unique and mm-hmm. special?
Yeah, that they can't possibly have with other people.
No, like Elio character is going to sleep with other attractive men in his life.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's really not there. And so when the father's saying what you had with him was really special, it's like, what we saw was sex, and sex is not something unique to two people. Like, it's something you can have with multiple people in your life, and get enjoyment out of. So, I think, I just feel like that moral, which is all about love and intellectual connection and emotional intimacy, does not have a lot to do with the story that's told, which is much, much more about people breaking through perceived social boundary to represent physical intimacy and sexual intimacy. So that's my feeling on that.
Yeah, so the point that I quickly had about Lady Bird, and this is much more like specific to Call Me By Your Name, in that there is a coming out scene in Lady Bird, spoilers if you haven't seen it, in which one character is sort of confessing his shame to the main character, Lady Bird. And he's this very, like, he's just this very kind of normal, passionate about theater type kid in the high school. And he was sort of discovered by the main character kissing a boy, and they had to end Lady Bird
and
the
Catholic
boy.
And it's a Catholic school.
And they're in a Catholic school, and so he feels just a lot of negative feelings and doesn't know how to tell his family, and just didn't have anybody to talk to about what he was going through. And that just strikes a chord with me because I've also lived that primarily, but like, just the way that that scene in particular is handled and how the film takes a very serious moment to acknowledge the characters in our world does wonders for building empathy for the characters in that world. So when a kid literally just like starts bawling and says like, I'm so ashamed, and talks to his Lady Bird friend, then the music swells and it's great. And it's this very just cathartic thing.
Because they do stuff.
Exactly.
Like they seem like real people, specific people, just like you were saying before, that specificity represents. And maybe that's just our personal thing. I'm very fascinated if anybody watches this podcast.
I know if any academics or critical writers are listening to this and are curious about our disagreements, feel free to write in.
Yeah, we'd love to know what we were missing, if we just didn't have the right lens to put on this film.
Hang on!
We
need to wrap this up! Someone's
at the door!
So, something that I struggle with are films that just don't go very far. Films that sort of stay within this very easy-to-understand box, like this very, just plain Jane scenario. Kind of like Call Me By Your Name. Like, it's a very easy-to-understand thing. There's nothing necessarily pushing it as far as, like, a hook. I know that sounds really corny, but bear with me. When I think of two of the most moving romantic films that I've seen in the past 5 years, two of my all-time favorites at this point are Her and are Moonlight. And the only reason I bring those up is because those are two films that have romances in them, but there's so much other things going on to bring you into what's happening in that world and what's happening between those characters, that it's like, it just happens on like, the film happens on multiple levels, and it's more interesting to watch, number one, and it's more believable that these characters are feeling this way within it. Does that sort of make sense?
Yeah, I think one of the most powerful parts of romantic stories are the walls put in between those lovers. Mm. In Casablanca, to go to the most classic, there's just an unending stream of things putting them apart. The World War II, they're in Morocco, one already has another partner. Like, there's so much putting them in, put in the way of them. Same thing with Her. It's a man and a machine. There's a lot of social stuff for that, and how do they navigate that? Mm-hmm. And Moonlight, it's very forefronted that they are in a culture that would just destroy them if they accepted themselves. In Call Me By Your Name, there's no real wall. Like, the parents of the child bring their openly gay, flamboyant friends over to the house and criticize him for not being open enough. Mm-hmm. So there's no logical external force keeping them apart in the film.
Yeah, there's, yeah, like one of the points that Jordy made at the very beginning of our conversation, there's nothing outside, and there's nothing really even necessarily explaining why Elio has his internalized homophobia in the first place, other than, it's the 80s!
Yeah, it's
that's
80s
just the way things
guy.
Were.
Yeah, and he liked to fuck ladies.
Yeah, so, you know, all of this is just our preferences. It's a wonder to us that these films have been so acclaimed. And all we're sort of saying is that dig fucking deeper.
Dig deeper, Call Me By Your Name.
Yes?
Leave that at the door. Should I? I'll go get that.
Yeah. You can go ahead and take a look.
Oh, hi, neighbor. Oh, it's our neighbor from upstairs.
Oh, cool.
Hey, what's going on? Hey, what do you got there?
What?
What's going on?
What? Whoa! I gotta go, guys. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time.